So in this video, we're going to try and describe some of the traditional surgical facelifts, how they're described and what those descriptions mean. Keep in mind, this is part of a series, and some of the videos that we've made previously, like the description of facial anatomy, might be helpful for you to understand this next video. So the facelift is really, the technical term is a rightedectomy. It just means that we're removing wrinkles. And this is a procedure that's been done for more than 100 years. Obviously, the procedure has changed over the years. We vary our technique based on, the types of changes that are required. Some people want a less invasive procedure. Some people want a more substantial result. So I think there's modifications to the basic technique that have occurred over the years that make the surgery look better and the recovery less, but also try and allow us to design a procedure that's more geared towards an individual rather than performing, the same procedure on everybody. A skin lift refers to the elevation of the facial skin through incisions around, in and around the ear, where really it's just the skin that's lifted. That's probably what was done initially 100 years ago, and I think that surgery has, continues to be done to a certain extent, but that's probably what is used the least these days. The problem with the skin lift is that you're pulling on a structure that is inherently elastic. So it's not particularly sturdy. When you pull on skin for a long period of time, skin has the ability to stretch under tension. So the results from a cutaneous or a skin-only facelift are usually pretty short-lived. So the problems encountered with skin-only facelifts encouraged surgeons to think about ways of improving their results. And I think the biggest advance was when surgeons started to manipulate or elevate the SMAS layer, and that's the thick fascial layer underneath the skin that isn't stretchy. It's a lot stiffer, it has more volume to it, so moving that SMAS layer around, tightening it and repositioning it can change the shape of the face in addition to allowing for tightening that lasts. And so that was a huge advantage in the development of the technique. So pulling on the SMAS has made a huge improvement in the results of facelift techniques over just pulling the skin. But since then, there's been even more advances in how that SMAS layer is dealt with and how it's repositioned that give even better results. So as an example, the Deep Plane Facelift, which I will talk about later. Regarding the SMAS layer, which is the thick fascial layer underneath the skin, there's several ways that layer can be manipulated. The first is SMAS plication, and that just means that we take the SMAS layer and we overlap it on itself so that as we're overlapping it, we're pulling it in the direction that we want to sharpen, for example, the jawline or the neck. That can be very helpful, and I think if that SMAS layer is mobile, particularly if someone is thin and we don't really want to remove that SMAS layer, we want to keep it so that it keeps as much of their volume as we can, I think that's a very reasonable technique. The second technique is called the lateral smasectomy. And what's done with that is a portion of the SMAS layer is removed, which creates a space. When that space is closed, it brings the anterior edge of the SMAS up to meet the posterior edge that was resected. And when you close that with stitches, of course, it's pulling on the jawline and it's pulling on the neck. And what's nice about that is it's a fairly quick procedure. A portion of the SMAS is removed so that in cases where you don't want to have too much volume where the SMAS is elevated, I think it's a great way to keep the contour of the face similar to what it was like before, but in a tightened fashion. But I think the big advantage with the smasectomy is that it's fairly quick. There's less dissection, so the surgery takes less time, and potentially there's less bruising as a result. So some of the disadvantages of plication or smasectomy are related to how much movement of the SMAS can be achieved with those techniques. So imagine trying to pull on your bed sheets when they're tucked in. You can pull on them a little bit, but ultimately they're being held in place by their attachments underneath the mattress. It's the same thing with the SMAS layer. If the SMAS is still attached and you pull on it, it'll pull a little bit, but it's still being held in place by some of the underlying structures. If you elevate the SMAS and lift it off of those structures, it's kind of like untucking your bed sheets. Once they're untucked, you can pretty much move them to the top of the bed or wherever you want. You can move them to the side, you can do whatever you want with them. And I think this is the key with SMAS elevation, is that if you elevate the SMAS off of its underlying structures, not only is it more mobile, but when you do pull it, all of those areas that have been elevated will then stick down onto their in their new position and give a further reinforcement to the lift that you get. So I think that the improvements can be more substantial when that SMAS layer is lifted off of its underlying attachments. That's what a deep plane facelift is. It's when that deep plane underneath the SMAS is dissected to free it up so that you get significant mobility. The difference between a deep plane lift and a SMAS lift, it's terminology. We're lifting the SMAS in both cases, but typically what a SMAS lift means is that you're pulling on the SMAS, but you're not separating it from its underlying structures. A deep plane lift refers to the elevation of that SMAS layer off of the underlying attachments, the parotid gland, the masseter muscles, the jawline. Once it's freed from those underlying structures, it's much more mobile. So the actual pull that is performed on this SMAS layer, once it's been dissected through the deep plane, is more substantial. So in someone who's got a very saggy neck that requires a lot of movement of the neck muscles in order to make that neck sharp, a deep plane lift gives a significant advantage in a case like that. So underneath the SMAS layer, there are ligaments that attach the SMAS to the underlying structures. And with a deep plane lift, those ligaments are divided so that they are loosened up and it allows that muscle to move substantially. So I think that what's really important about these different techniques is determining what degree of movement of the SMAS layer is required to give the patient a good result. If someone just needs a little bit of movement of the SMAS and their SMAS layer is mobile when we're doing the surgery, I think application or SMASectomy is a very worthwhile technique, and I use that in cases that are appropriate. In someone who has a very, very lax neck or very heavy skin and they need a substantial amount of movement of the SMAS layer in order to recontour their neck substantially, I think a deep plane lift works better in a situation like that by far. The other reason we really want to manipulate this SMAS and move it substantially and independently is that when we can move the SMAS layer to wherever we want, we can sharpen the jawline, we can re-volumize the cheek, we can make the neck substantially tighter, but independently we can move the skin to where we want it. So we might re-volumize the cheek and sharpen the jawline, but when we pull on the skin, we want to pull it in a separate direction so that it softens or flattens the nasolabial fold. So it really gives us the ability to change the skin independent of the volume underneath. And I think that's a really important factor in making people look natural. If you have to pull really, really hard on the skin in one direction only in order to sharpen the jawline or sharpen the neck, often it makes the skin look unusual. So although the deep plane lift can give a much more substantial elevation of the tissues, allows for customization in terms of revolumizing the jawline and the cheek. Not a lot of surgeons do that. It's a complicated procedure. It does take longer to do, and it does require some expertise that, you know, maybe not everybody feels that they're comfortable with. There are various types of facelifts that I use. As an example, I very frequently do what's called a mini lift. The incisions are the same as a facelift, with the exception that we don't really extend the incision into the hairline behind the ear, but the skin is elevated a very short distance. So rather than lifting the skin down into the neck or well out into the cheek, we're only really lifting the skin out, 5 or 10 centimeters from the ear, so not a lot of skin is elevated. I do still need to elevate the skin far enough that I can access the SMAS layer that's mobile. There's no point pulling on the SMAS right in front of the ear. The SMAS there is attached to the parotid gland. It's not going to move. Further forward, however, the SMAS layer is mobile. And so where it's mobile is where we want to try and elevate the SMAS to sharpen the jawline and to try and get some revolumization in the cheek. The limitation of the mini lift is that it really doesn't address the neck. So there are lots of people out there that just have a little bit of a jowl, or they've just sort of gotten a bit of flattening in the cheek. Very good candidates for a mini lift, don't really need to have a full facelift. That's where it comes into play. The odd time I will see patients who probably would benefit from a deep plane facelift or a more comprehensive treatment, but they want to have something that has less downtime. And there's no question that with the mini lift, there's less bruising, there's less swelling, and I think the recovery is different. So for some people, they choose the procedure based on recovery time, and for other people, they choose the procedure based on trying to choose the surgery that is going to work the best for them. So I want to introduce an important concept, and that is skin elevation. The skin in the face, when pulled, accumulates. So imagine if I pull my jawline, I end up with some extra skin here. That extra skin needs to be removed. The more movement of the face, the more movement of the neck, the more skin needs to be removed. So techniques that try and tighten the face without actually removing skin run into problems like that. So imagine if you were putting threads in there and pulling on the jawline, what are you going to do with all that extra skin? So the amount of skin that is elevated contributes to how much can be removed. What's more important is that in order to access the parts of the SMAS layer underneath which are truly mobile, the skin needs to be lifted far enough that I can access those layers. So just as an example, the SMAS, of course, comes all the way across the jawline up into the neck, but is very firmly attached to the sternocleidomastoid muscle here. It's very firmly attached to the parotid fascia, which is the capsule on the parotid gland. There's really no point pulling on this mass when it's attached to the parotid or attached to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It's not going to pull. So if you only lift the skin far enough that you're accessing the part of this mass that's attached, it doesn't really help you move this mass layer. It needs to be elevated far enough that you can address or access the part of this mass that actually moves. So with a mini lift, for example, I try and keep the flap fairly short, but I do still need to go far enough that I can access the part of this mass that will actually move. So a little facelift where you remove a little bit of skin here is not going to do anything. You need to lift that skin far enough that you're gonna be able to pull on this mass. What does that result in? It does result in some bruising. It does result in a little bit of numbness of the skin. There's no way to, you know, make a little incision, remove a bit of skin, and actually get a result that's, you know, particularly significant. So you have to be a bit careful not to be too minimally invasive with these surgeries, as you may not get enough of an improvement that it's worthwhile for patients. Now, as our facelifts get bigger and I need to elevate more SMAS and I end up with a lot more extra skin at the end of the day once we've pulled everything, then the skin flaps need to be longer and longer. And that's not necessarily harder on the patient. You know, it's just that there's probably more chance of a bit of bruising, there's more chance of some numbness of the skin if the amount of skin that we're elevating is more. But it doesn't necessarily result in a longer recovery period for an individual person. They may do a mini lift and recover in 2 weeks, they may do a full facelift and recover in 2 weeks. But on average, the bigger lifts, the more we elevate the skin, the longer the bruising and the longer it takes for people to get back to normal activities. So the other modifications to the facelift procedures include variations in the length of the incision that we make, and also the addition of procedures aimed at removing fat, or even more significantly tightening the anterior part of the neck, and that's called the platysmaplasty. So in my practice we do, you know, 3 or 4 different types of facelifts in terms of where the incisions are placed, how much skin is removed, and whether or not we're accessing the mid portion of the neck. So a short incision facelift is really a true facelift. We're dissecting quite far anteriorly underneath the skin. We're accessing the mobile part of the SMAS. We're going underneath the SMAS into the deep layer and substantially moving those tissues. But what we're not doing is we're not extending the incision back into the hairline. There's not that many situations where I'd recommend that procedure. I don't think it does as good of a job at redraping the skin in the neck because we're not including an incision that we can use to move all that extra skin to. But in the odd person that has a really heavy jowl and some fairly heavy lateral neck tissues, I think it can be very useful. It minimizes the length of the incision. Does that make a difference for the recovery? Probably not significantly. I think it's still a fairly substantial procedure. I think there's still the same degree of bruising and swelling, but I guess they don't really have that incision to deal with behind the ear. The odd person who doesn't have a particularly low hairline is anxious about having an incision that they might see. And so we have to consider those issues with each person. But I would say with the short scar facelifts, it's not something I recommend that often. So there's lots of other short scar facelift techniques. There's lots of other names for how we modify the SMAS layer. And I'll just give you some common examples. So one is called the max lift. And what a max lift is, it stands for minimal access cranial suspension. It just means that we're making a fairly short incision and that we're suspending this mass layer in a vertical dimension. It was described in Europe many years ago now. There is a suture technique that's used in this mass layer. It's sort of a purse string suture that's placed in and out of the SMAS, and as it tightens, it pulls the SMAS layer superiorly. Thousands of these procedures have been performed worldwide. I've done this procedure many times. For me, it doesn't give me as much control over the direction of pull that I would necessarily want, but I think it's a very valid procedure. Lots of people do it, and I think overall it gives good results. So that's one, you know, commonly used term, the max lift, for a procedure that is probably similar to what I would consider a short scar facelift. Some of the other techniques that I've heard described are the high SMAS, which really refers to elevation of the SMAS in the cheek in a vertical direction. And that's something that I would almost do routinely in patients, particularly if they're slim. Often we want to try and get the apex of the cheek prominence to be slightly higher. It makes the lower lid look shorter, and we do that by using the SMAS layer and actually elevating it superiorly when we do the surgery. Again, you do need to lift the skin far enough that you can access that SMAS layer in order to elevate it vertically. So another reason why sometimes our skin flaps are longer in some patients than others. If someone's got a really full cheek and they've just got a laxity along the jawline, there's really no reason to do a high SMAS technique. But I find a lot of our patients, they've gotten a little slimmer as they've aged, and they do benefit from some reshaping of the cheek, so I often use a high SMAS technique. The neck is the most common concern in our facelift patients. A lot of our patients are in their 50s or even in their 60s, and I think they've been using a lot of the modern techniques for keeping their skin looking good, for revolumizing their tissues, and they really look great to about here. There's really nothing that works that well in the neck. I've had patients try using fillers. It really is of no benefit there. I've had patients come in and tell me that they had Botox injected into their neck muscles. Exactly the opposite of what we want to do in the neck. We don't want those muscles relaxed, we want to tighten them. So tightening in the neck is the one thing that I think, when we get a good result, makes the biggest difference. And it's a very large area. There's a large muscle in the neck called the platysma that needs to be suspended. And I think this is where the deep plane lifts really come into their own. When that platysma layer is significantly elevated and moved dramatically, it makes a really big difference in the neck. Keep in mind that that platysma is being pulled from two sides, so it actually acts like a sling. And so when that's pulled very, very tightly, the neck tucks up dramatically. That can be enhanced by the use of a chin implant to bring the chin forward. Sometimes I use a midline or an anterior platysmoplasty, which is a procedure designed to remove some of the fat and tighten up the muscles in the midline. But in general, a good deep plane elevation of the SMAS layer in the neck can make a really big difference with a facelift, and often that is what bothers people the most, is that their neck is out of keeping with the rest of their face. And I think, you know, trying to cut corners and just do a mini lift on someone who has significant laxity in the neck, you know, might be a bit of a disservice to the patient. It's nice to have a fast recovery, it's nice to have faster surgeries, but I think a thorough rejuvenation in the neck often goes a long way. Stay tuned, because in some of our next videos, we're gonna talk about what to expect from facelift incisions and what to expect for the recovery process.